This week on Wealth Track, the challenging search for retirement income in a low-return world. Kiplinger's retirement income specialist, Mary Beth Franklin, award-winning financial planner, Harold Evensky, and Citi's director of financial education, Jonathan Clements, identify some income streams. Next on Consuelo Mack, Wealth Track. So, you know, Jonathan, one of the things that you told me is that the most important point is that not the total value of your nest egg, but it's basically what kind of income that nest egg can generate. So that's a real kind of a new way of thinking for a lot of us, not for you three, but for a lot of us it is. So how do we, you know, how does that change the way we approach our, you know, maximizing our retirement income by thinking of what our portfolio can generate?
I think this is a really important issue, and to some extent it can help to make you a calmer investor, because you think about it, you buy a collection of stocks and it gives you, let's say, a 2.5% dividend yield. The stocks soar in value, the actual dollar value of the dividends you're getting is probably not changed. Similarly, even if the stock market plunges, the dollar value of the dividends that you're getting every quarter probably doesn't change all that much. So if you're a retiree and you're thinking about income, it isn't really the total value of the portfolio that matters, what it is this month or next month, it's how much income it can generate. And so we talk about various approaches that mm-hmm. you might take to generating income. An alternative approach that people might think about, because I think this is really, in the end, a big behavioral problem. You want to settle on a strategy that you can live with. So an alternative strategy is what I call the floor. And the notion here is you think about what is the minimum income that you need to cover your basic living expenses, you know, pay the groceries, pay the utilities, pay your property taxes, whatever it is. And so you set out to generate that through some combination of Social Security, any pension you're entitled to, interest from your bonds, dividends from your stocks, maybe you put part of the money into a plain vanilla immediate fixed annuity. You generate enough income to cover those basic living expenses. In bad years for the market, you've got that income to live off. In good years for the market, you can cash in some of your gains, and maybe that's the year that you go to Paris.
Mm-hmm. All right, so again, that's a really different way of thinking of it. So the issue on the table is maximizing retirement income,
right,
or whatever. So let's talk some specifics.
I agree with what Jonathan said, is that there is this mind shift from the number being
right. The
nest egg, the million, the $2 million nest egg, into
right. What
does that nest egg translate into retirement income? And it's a very humbling when you think that a conservative rule of thumb says you really should restrict your first year withdrawals in retirement to
4%.
So out of $1 million, that's $40,000
a
year.
Right.
That's pretty amazing. If you
it's much lower than people realize who have $1 million.
And that's not factoring taxes.
Right.
And the question is, after the sort of bear market we have lived through, many strategists said, and that's not conservative enough, that 4% withdrawal worked in about 90% of the cases, but we just lived through the other 10%. As a result, and as Harold mentioned, a lot of people will probably never recover from those market losses. The answer for a lot of people in retirement will not just be market securities. In some cases, people may have to take some of their assets and buy an insurance product called an annuity. This gives you a bigger bang for your buck. Instead of getting 2% on CDs, you put $100,000 with an insurance company to pay out the rest of your life, it's going to pay out about 7%. Why? Because you're using your principal and your earnings at the same time.
Right.
And it's a permanent decision. These are decisions not to be made lightly. You do need to talk to some sort of financial counselor to figure out what's right for you. But the bottom line is, you add up all your fixed costs in retirement and you compare them to your guaranteed sources of income, your Social Security, maybe a pension, and whatever gap is left, you need to fill that somehow. And the right answer for some people might be an immediate annuity.
All right, so that's interesting. So, and again, when you're looking at that $1 million or that $500,000, whatever it is, and so instead of just thinking of it as I can only take 4%, when a lot of people are saying there's no way I can live on the 4% withdrawals, You look at it a different ways to invest it, right?
Look for a different way, but I would tell those people, I'm sorry you can't live on it, but you better be prepared to.
Right.
You know, the market
so
doesn't
get real.
Care what people, exactly. The market really doesn't care what you think you need. It's
right.
going to be what it is.
Right.
And the only thing that scares me about maximizing is because it suggests there's some silver bullet out there that's
right.
going to solve it. And there isn't. People are going to have to get real and adjust to reality. Immediate annuities are going to be, I believe, an extraordinarily important part because they provide a return nothing else does, a mortality return. Mm-hmm. It means that if you do that and you die, in effect, early, you didn't make a very good deal, but you're dead. You don't care. But if you live beyond that,
your heirs care, but who cares?
Right.
Right.
we care about you.
Right, right, exactly.
If you live longer, you're picking up, in effect, the money others left on the table. But it doesn't really become a viable alternative until someone is relatively older. That mortality.
So how much older
around,
should you be?
Well, the mortality return really kicks in around age 70 or so. So it's at that point at which it becomes a very viable investment
right.
vehicle.
Well, I mean, I know one of the things that all of you have said, Harold, not you necessarily, but I know Mary Beth and Jonathan, when they've been on the show before, has also said just work longer so that you don't, you know, withdraw
that's
from,
how you maximize.
From your... Right, that's
right,
how you maximize
right.
what you've got.
And people should not overlook the value of Social Security. It is
right.
so important. It's the only guaranteed pension cost of living adjustment that virtually every American has.
Yeah.
And the longer you wait to collect it, the more valuable it will be.
Right.
Jonathan, you were going to say something, I know.
Well, I think one of the things that people should realize is when they say, okay, there's a 4% withdrawal rate, and that's the withdrawal rate that you should consider using, there's a reason they end up at that number. Retirement is an enormously complicated financial problem.
Right.
I mean, there are all kinds of risks that retirees face. They face the risk that they'll get low absolute returns. They face the risk that they may retire and immediately get hit by a bear market
as
that
they
eviscerates
did
their savings.
Right in 08 and 09, right.
They face the risk of inflation. They face the risk of high unexpected expenses such as long-term care expenses. And maybe the biggest risk of all, which is longevity risk. You don't know how long you're going to live.
Right, the risk they may not die.
Right.
And that's why you end up with this very low withdrawal rate. But you can start to boost it up if you're willing to do things like buy an annuity that pays lifetime income. You can also increase your income if you're willing to delay Social Security mm-hmm. to your full retirement age or even to age 70, often a very smart strategy. So there are ways to get the number up. Working part-time is also a good idea. So the 4% represents what you end up with all these risks, but if you can think of ways to cope with those risks, maybe you can get the percentage up a little bit.